Good morning and welcome. I'm Dean Reuter, Vice President and Director of Practice Groups at the Federalist Society. Thank you all for being here today. And welcome to our second showcase panel as the Federalist Society launches its years-long project on the role of Congress and continues to roll out its new blog, which can be found on the Federalist Society's website. I'd like to extend a special welcome to those of you watching on C-SPAN. I've also been asked to let you know that the Federalist Society convention was trending on Twitter yesterday. And we'd like to keep up that momentum. Now, if you know what that means, trending, then you know what to do to keep it going, and you already know the convention's hashtag. If you don't know what trending means, it's too late today to educate you in the finer points of tweet. But to make you feel better, I admit that I really don't know what trending means, but I know it's good, so thank you to those. To those of you who are tweeting. I have one other important housekeeping note about Magna Carta, and that of course reminds me of a brief story. As implausible as it might sound, I played football in high school at a small school that had never before had a football team, and we were terrible. We're just awful, and almost none of my teammates had ever played organized football before, and some might argue that even after two full seasons, they still hadn't played organized football. Anyhow, I had the good fortune to score the first touchdown in school history, and the local newspaper there carried a well-timed photograph of that moment, and someone kindly framed the picture and gave it to me as a keepsake. And years later, after I had started my family, that picture was displayed on a side table in my dining room. And by this time, I had two small children. And one day, I rounded the corner into that dining room, unseen by my children. And they were looking at the photo, and my son, probably about 5 or 6 years old, sagely explained to his younger sister, "That's how football looked in the olden days." And my daughter, 4 years old, nodded her head knowingly. I don't know where that comment came from, because it's a color photograph, and we were wearing helmets, not leather helmets. But speaking of the olden days, this is how we tie into the housekeeping announcement. Please do make a point of visiting the Palm Court Room that's down the hall on the left. It's our business lounge, but it's also where we have a wonderful exhibit on Magna Carta, celebrating the 800th anniversary of that formative document. Now, 800 years, that's the olden days. So the exhibit's going to be here as long as we are, and I assure you it's worth your time to make a visit. Turning to our programming, yesterday in our first showcase panel, a video recording of which you can find on the Federalist Society's website, we discussed the founder's original vision of Congress. This morning, we will continue that discussion, exploring whether and how in the modern era Congress has departed from that vision and whether this is a good or bad thing. To lead our discussion, we welcome back with great appreciation a familiar and friendly face, Judge Jerry Smith of the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals. Judge Smith.
Thank you, Dean, and as Dean said, our topic is the living Congress, adaptation or decline. The first thing we might want to ask is what do we really mean by a living Congress? And I expect our panelists are going to have some healthy disagreements and discussion on that, but I suppose we could all probably agree that a living Congress is better than a dead one, or is it? That may be. So in yesterday's panels, as Dean mentioned, we've already examined whether Congress is too strong or too weak and whether it's fulfilling its proper constitutional role. And there are a lot of other subordinate questions that our distinguished panel will be addressing. This is a spectacular group of panelists, and I won't take any extra time to delve into detailed introductions because you have their materials available, but I'll mention the order in which they'll be speaking. Leading off is Christopher DeMuth, a distinguished fellow at the Hudson Institute here in Washington. I have to say, as a Yalie, I'll try to forgive the fact that he's a graduate of Harvard College. But other than that, he's very well qualified. Next is Neil Devins, a professor of William & Mary Law School since 1987 with a focus on constitutional law. Then we'll hear from Jillian Metzger, professor at Columbia Law School, who teaches administrative and constitutional law. Following Professor Metzger is an old friend of mine, Naomi Rao, a professor at George Mason University School of Law, teaching constitutional law and legislation. And finally, we have David Mayhew, professor of political science at Yale, with extensive writings on the American political experience. All right, we'll begin with Christopher DeMuth.
Thank you, Judge Smith. The living Congress is adapting and declining. It has manifestly declined in the formal sense of declining to exercise more and more of its constitutional powers. Since 1970, it has gone far beyond progressive and New Deal precedents in creating numerous new executive agencies and giving them sweeping lawmaking power over large swaths of the economy. It has encouraged the 1970s informal rulemaking revolution, whereby the agencies used Section 553 of the Administrative Procedure Act to build a powerful engine of executive lawmaking that the authors of that statute could never have imagined. It has acquiesced in progressively more aggressive seizures of legislative power, especially during the administrations of George W. Bush and Barack Obama. In recent decades, it has surrendered much of its power of the purse by converting most annual spending into automatic entitlements and, for the remainder, abandoning in most years annual appropriating of funds for agencies in favor of massive government-wide continuing resolutions. In recent years, it has created several agencies of independent means, with their own sources of revenue and, in some cases, even outright taxing power. And most recently, it has handed off its borrowing authority to the Treasury, permitting the Treasury to borrow as needed for a set period of time, which it continually extends into the future, most recently 2 weeks ago. Changes this profound and continuous must be adapting to something, but to what? I believe that Congress is adapting to modernity, to modern affluence and education levels, to modern technology, especially communications and information technologies, and to modern cultural attitudes. The elected representative legislature was a great innovation of the 17th and 18th centuries, with some earlier precedents, the Magna Carta, some in ancient Athens and Rome. It was, in the modern world, the elected legislature, the vehicle of Republican aspirations against the prerogatives of kings and despots. But it reflected the world in which it was created, where only elites, a select few, had the capacity or interest to engage in politics, where government was small and the demands upon it were modest, and where the transaction costs of politics and government were very large. But today, a large part of the population, many, many people, have the time, resources, and interests to engage in political activity, and the transaction costs of organizing lobby groups on the demand side of government and on the supply side mounting political careers have fallen drastically. The demands on Congress for particular policy interventions are vastly greater than they were a half a century ago. Within the halls of Congress, individual members have become much more independent, less dependent upon party and congressional hierarchies to sustain their careers. The way to supply much more policy than the inherently cumbersome, slow-moving Congress can manage is to delegate policymaking to specialized, mission-oriented executive agencies, which can be multiplied essentially without limit, and which can make use of modern information and communications technologies with much greater alacrity than a Congress could ever mount. In place of a body of diverse representatives who made law by negotiating deals and compromising their differences, Naomi Rao's collective choice, Congress has become a congeries of solo practitioners who delegate the real choices to agencies and then lobby them on behalf of the groups that support their careers. Other sources of decline are cultural. The modern mind values identity over locality, rationalism over representation, and decision over deliberation. Each of the three branches of government have distinctive principles of operation and legitimacy. The judiciaries are reason, rational explanation, and a resolution. The executives, since the age of Andy Jackson, are personality, action, decision, and national aspiration. In contrast, the legislature's principles of legitimacy and operation are much less impressive: representation and compromise. Individual members can almost never act decisively on their own. Collective decisions can rarely be rationalized from any standpoint of a priori principle. Legislation is based on unprincipled compromise. Moreover, representing distinct geographic localities is not what it used to be. Due to the globalization of commerce and culture and much greater personal mobility, locality is not without importance today, but many people care much more about their personal values, group identities, vocational interests, avocational causes, and these are as likely to be represented by specific mission-oriented agencies as by the congressman or senator that may represent you. I believe that these developments are not simply a matter of constitutional fastidiousness, but are the source of more profound political decline. We have a system that depends on robust competition among the three branches, and especially between the two political branches. We are losing that in the form of a new regime of predominantly executive government, where power has become dangerously concentrated and unconstrained. Concentrated power is a reliable source of corruption and abuse. We see many plausible examples of corruption today that are going unchecked, such as at the IRS and at the VA hospitals. Those of you who specialize in administrative law at the FDA or the FCC or the EPA can probably rattle off many routine examples of innocence sacrificed to bureaucratic imperatives. The organization of government, as it is becoming by innumerable specialized policy silos, is producing too much law. The penetration of government coercion into many areas of life that would be better left to private markets and voluntary ordering. Specialization has many virtues, including in the law, but when it is coupled with coercive power, it tends to go to extremes. It tends to be oblivious to the wider world. We saw a dramatic example of this in the conduct of the housing and financial agencies leading up to the collapse of 2008. And to produce cultures of policymaking that are relatively immune to criticism and improvement. I think that the result is that too much of society becomes politicized and therefore, as we say these days, polarized, leading to the paradox that has been mentioned by several people at this convention so far, that our public now distrusts, even loathes the government, and yet collectively demands more and more of it. What should be done? It's easy to stand at a podium and say that Congress should retrieve its lawmaking and taxing and spending and borrowing powers and exercise them vigorously. But the first principle of congressional restoration has to be that the steps taken have to accommodate, they have to work with the deep political and cultural and technological developments that I have mentioned, rather than trying to repeal them and turn back the clock. I see some possibilities here. The sine qua non of congressional restoration is to rebuild a strong committee system of the committees of jurisdiction and authorization. Speaker Paul Ryan is already beginning to do this, and there is some of this going on in the Senate as well. The committee system itself was not displaced by technology. It was the work of Northern Democrat, capital D, Democratic liberals in the wake of the Civil Rights Revolution in the late 60s. Which had discredited the Dixiecrats who dominated the committee system. That is a long ago memory. It no longer casts a pall of illegitimacy over strong committees that are presided over by the likes of the people that have done so in recent years. But I want to conclude by emphasizing one paradox or dilemma in congressional reform. Speaker Paul Ryan, in his initial remarks to Congress right after he was elected the other week, and Senator Michael Lee, in his remarks to this convention yesterday, emphasized that reform to them meant especially empowering individual members. If you've listened to what I have said, the empowerment of individual members, where the legislature acts as a solo practitioner rather than as a member of a mechanism of collective deliberative choice, is the problem. So when I hear congressional reform described as empowering the individual more, that strikes me as a paradox. And Senator Lee even went so far as to say that the Uber model could be the means of empowering members of Congress. But I see the advance of technology as a huge inducement for the delegation of power to more effective and to more efficient executive lawmaking agencies. I think it is possible to reconcile this paradox. And I would look to the example of developments, the most important developments in the modern economy in the large corporation, from the assembly line of old manufacturing industries to the most advanced technology industries represented by such as Google and Microsoft, where they are developing new models of decision making, which is far more participatory, that draws upon the human capital and diverse perspectives within the organization to a far greater degree than was done in times of yore, and yet combines this commitment to participation with a recognition by all concerned that at some point decisive action has to be made. I believe that effective congressional reform, consistent with modern values and modern political pressures, should look to the models that have been developed in these corporations for a new form of congressional decision making. Thank you.
So I want to talk about the conditions under which Congress is willing to assert its institutional authority and check the president. In particular, I want to draw a comparison between the dynamic that took place during the Watergate era, when Congress was willing to stand up for its prerogatives and check presidential unilateralism. Contrast that to the modern Congress, where George Bush, Barack Obama, and undoubtedly the next president will be able to largely
run free in large measure because of party polarization and its consequences. So before talking about the Watergate period and talking about the specifics, just a couple of general comments about the incentives of Congress, the incentives of the executive branch. So for Congress, for the executive branch, let me start with the president. The president's personal ambitions and the institutional interests of the presidency go hand in glove. When the president pushes the boundaries of presidential authority to pursue his policy initiatives, he's accomplishing what he wants as a matter of public policy. He's also expanding the power of the presidency. There's no conflict between the two. The president's personal interests and the interests of the presidency are one and the same. On the other hand, in Congress, there's a collective action problem. Members often trade off congressional power, trade off institutional interest in order to pursue personal interest, in order to pursue, for example, reelection or their favored policy. So just a couple of obvious examples. With respect to policy questions, those who oppose the Affordable Care Act argued before the Supreme Court that Congress had limited power under the Commerce Clause, limited power under the Spending Clause. The opponents of the bill were not pushing for a broad view of congressional power and prerogatives. And then sometimes, war powers in particular, lawmakers feel there's little personal gain in challenging the president and presidential unilateralism, and they stand aside and acquiesce to what the president does. So in Congress, unlike the presidency, the personal interests of members do not always coalesce with the interest of Congress as an institution and expanding institutional authority. So let me now use that as a baseline to talk a little bit about what happened in the Watergate era, why Congress was willing to check the president, and contrast that to the modern era. So Nixon was a president who asserted unilateral authority in all sorts of ways. On war making, he claimed essentially unchecked power over military operations in Southeast Asia. He issued executive orders reorganizing the government, created the EPA essentially that way. He's invoked executive privilege to frustrate legislative oversight. He refused to spend appropriated funds. He did a range of things. This was dubbed the Imperial Presidency for that reason. But Congress did not stand aside and let this happen. Congress instead fought back. On war powers, even though the act is muddled, Democrats and Republicans came together to enact the War Powers Resolution of 73, the stated purpose of which was to, quote, fulfill the intent of the framers by making sure the introduction of U.S. forces to foreign hostilities reflect the collective judgment of both Congress and the president. With respect to Nixon's not spending appropriated funds, Congress enacted the Impoundment Control Act. And I should mention, with the War Powers Resolution, a bipartisan Congress overturned Nixon's veto of the bill. On impoundment, with no dissents in the Senate and only six in the House, Congress enacted Impoundment Control Act of 1974, and that was legislation intended to, quote, restore responsibility for spending policy of the United States to the legislative branch, to make Congress the primary branch of government on appropriations. So Congress enacted these measures in bipartisan ways, and bipartisanship was also in effect during the Watergate scandal itself, both with the willingness of Republicans to vote for articles of impeachment and also Congress coming together as a bipartisan entity to restrict executive branch investigations of high-ranking executive officials through the Ethics in Government Act and the Independent Counsel provision. So during the Watergate era, Congress did a range of things to assert its authority and to seek to limit presidential power. And the reason for this is tied to two pretty obvious phenomena. One is that this was politically popular to do, right? So voters wanted Congress to assert itself. They were concerned about what had happened in Vietnam. They wanted to prevent future Watergates. They wanted to prevent abuses of presidential power. And not only was it politically popular, and this is a major contrast between the Congress of the 70s and today's Congress, bipartisanship was possible at that time. Democrats and Republicans were not divided the way they are today. There were many Southern Democrats that pushed the Democratic Party towards the center. There were the so-called Rockefeller Republicans that pushed the Republican Party towards the center. Indeed, George Wallace justified his presidential run in 68 by saying that there wasn't a dime's worth of difference between Democrats and Republicans. It was an era in which each political party occupied all ideological niches. So let's move on to today and see how today is different and perhaps why today's Congress is unwilling to check the president. Here, Democrats and Republicans, even though they may be individuals, as Chris DeMuth was just saying, nonetheless, they also identify with party in very profound ways, and a great deal of energy is spent with Democrats seeking to embarrass and limit the authority of Republicans and vice versa. There's a lot of efforts of each party to triumph its own authority by limiting the authority of the other party. And related to that, and perhaps even more important, is that members of the president's party are largely loyal to the president, rarely are willing to stand up against the president to assert congressional authority. And there are many examples of that, examples during the George W. Bush administration, the Obama administration today. Here are just a couple of pretty obvious ones. So when House Democrats investigated the firing of U.S. attorneys, when George W. Bush was president in 2007, nearly all Democrats and essentially only a couple of Republicans were willing to vote in favor of contempt of Congress against Harriet Myers and Joshua Bolten. More recently, with Attorney General Holder and the current administration, House Republicans investigated the fast and furious gun smuggling operations, and here this tide, the roles were just simply reversed, where essentially nearly all Republicans and very few Democrats were willing to vote contempt of Attorney General Holder and pursue litigation to assert congressional prerogatives in the face of executive privilege claims. Another example is the Supreme Court case Canning involving recess appointments, where the Senate's confirmation power was put on the line. And rather than seeing Democrats and Republicans join together, instead what happened was all Republicans joined together in a brief filed on behalf of the Republican Party, Republican senators, that is, before the U.S. Supreme Court. It was Miguel Estrada appearing for Republican senators, asserting their view that the president had gone too far, and off on the sidelines stood the Democratic senators, none of whom participated in any of this and said nothing about the president's assertion of recess appointment authority. So with this as backdrop, with the president's party backing presidential authority, not congressional power, the opposition party seeking to embarrass the president, lawmakers today are unable to come together in a bipartisan way to assert congressional authority. They're not advancing an affirmative legislative agenda. They're not checking presidential assertions of authority. And presidents, not shockingly, are filling the gap and expanding their own authority through executive orders, presidential directives, and this type of thing. George Bush did this with his faith-based initiative, pursued through an executive order. President Obama has pursued major immigration reforms through unilateral action as well. And so here we are at the eve, if you will, of the 2016 elections, and I don't think there's evidence to suggest that this is going to change. So the one thing that seems likely with the next administration is that the power of the presidency will again expand, and the power of the Congress vis-a-vis the presidency will again be diminished. And obviously, in a system of government premise on ambition counteracting ambition, things are not working at all. Thank you.
Thank you. So the theme of my remarks today is going to be one you've already heard mentioned, and that's delegation. Congressional delegation of authority is a central feature of our national government today, and the central feature of the living Congress that we now have. And I want to make three points about delegation. The first is that broad congressional delegations of authority of the type that we have today are constitutional. The second is that such delegation fundamentally transforms the effects of partisan polarization in Congress. And the third is that we need to think much harder about the consequences of delegation. Delegations are constitutional, but that doesn't mean they come without constitutional strings attached. So let me start with my first point. Broad congressional delegations of authority are constitutional, at least as far as the courts are concerned. My comments are not particularly original. I think it's fair to say that the constitutional pros and cons of delegation are well rehearsed. I think Naomi deserves great credit for coming up with a new one to an otherwise fairly fairly old debate. But let me just summarize. So under any approach to constitutional interpretation that gives pride of place to precedent or to evolving constitutional understandings, broad delegations are plainly constitutional. The Supreme Court has long and consistently upheld delegations, except for the two during the early New Deal. The lower federal courts, the D.C. Circuit in particular, occasionally has tried to strike one down and been reversed by the Supreme Court. The political branches have constructed a state, an administrative state, that is based on delegation, signaling that they believe delegation to be constitutional, and further that any effort to pull back on delegation would be profoundly disruptive. And that leads to the fact that principles of self-governance and democratic accountability today also support the constitutionality of delegation. The delegation we have is the delegation that the people of the United States have built. The main attacks on delegation are therefore rooted in originalism and constitutional structure. I don't find either persuasive. As for originalism, I think recent historical work has demonstrated that administrative delegations have been around ever since the Constitution's beginnings. More importantly, to my mind, the world is a very different place today. Picking up on Chris's point about modernity, we have a massively complex society and economy. From a framework originalism standpoint, or a point that understands the need to translate to the situation of today, you have to look at how the original understandings would apply in today's world. And a critical feature of today's world is that absent delegation, Congress could not function. Simply not up to legislate at the level of detail with the kind of expertise, responsiveness, and flexibility that modern challenges require. So on any originalist account that understands Congress, the Constitution, as intending Congress to meaningfully wield legislative power, the acceptability of delegations must follow. That's also, then, a very important structural argument in favor of delegation. A second structural argument in favor of delegation is that once you accept the principle of delegation, drawing the line between a delegation that goes too far and delegations that are limited enough to be more palatable is simply not a task that the courts are institutionally competent to do. There are no principled or consistent standards by which a delegation that goes too far can be identified. There is also, of course, the text of the Necessary and Proper Clause, and efforts by some interesting originalist scholarship recently to impose limits on delegation based on the Necessary and Proper Clause have been, I think, the latest salvo. I think those also fail. I think these arguments about the meaning of necessary and proper, emphasizing on proper, are at odds with early precedent, and I also think, more fundamentally, they're circular. They rely on principles of separation of powers and federalism to conclude that delegations are improper, but of course, whether or not those principles of federalism and separation of powers foreclose delegation is exactly the question at issue. This is not to deny that delegations have a profound impact. To my mind, the strongest arguments about delegation turn on that impact and turn in particular on the way that we have had an expanded executive authority as a result. But I don't believe that the Constitution gives the courts the role to play in scrutinizing delegations and enforcing any constitutional limits. Instead, I think the Constitution entrusts policing of delegation to the political branches. Where the courts do have a role to play, and I think it's an important one, is in the subconstitutional realm. In particular, by guarding against arbitrary administrative decision making, and in policing the procedures and other constraints that Congress imposes on agencies. So this brings me to my second point. What is the impact of delegation, particularly on partisan polarization? Now, as Neil has mentioned, partisan polarization significantly limits Congress's ability to check presidential unilateralism, and polarization also increases the likelihood of presidential unilateralism. Polarization also makes it more likely that presidents will assert policy control over the administrative branch, and that administrative actions will have a decidedly presidential cast. Delegation is critical here, because it's the pre-existing and ongoing delegations of authority to the president that allow much of that presidential unilateralist action, at least in the domestic arena. But Congress's failure and in terms of its ability to check the president in a polarized world we're in today does not mean that executive power goes unchecked. Instead, you have a system of alternative checks that develops. One is familiar. It's the subconstitutional role of the courts that I already mentioned. And it's interesting that if you look at what's happening in administrative law today, we're seeing a bit of a pullback in terms of deference that may be correlated to the sense that the courts may need to be playing more of a checking role. I want to emphasize, though, a second and less prominent check, and that is the states. Congress has not just delegated broad authority to the executive branch. Congress has delegated authority to the executive branch to constitute programs and regulatory regimes that fundamentally turn on the states for implementation and execution. At a time of national political polarization, the inclusion of the states into federal programs and federal regulation brings in political dissension and resistance into the very executive functioning of the government. It can also bring in bipartisanship and compromise, with the executive branch having to reach agreements with state leaders from the opposite party in order to move forward with federal programs and federal regulation. And finally, the bipartisanship and policy development that executive branch and state agreements allow also could potentially have some feedback effects on Congress by changing the status quo and exercising, in that sense, a form of agenda control, and also by potentially breaking down some of the partisan divides, which may reshape, but nonetheless may allow some progress in Congress to enact legislation. This is highly speculative. It's a little bit hard to have any optimism right now about anything breaking through the partisan divides in Congress. But I think it's worth exploring at a time when solutions on that front seem so much in need. I want to say finally a few words on my third point, which is, what are the constitutional consequences of delegation? I think constitutional writing on delegation has focused too much on the question of whether delegations are constitutional and too little on what follows from delegation. And again, just because delegations are constitutional doesn't mean they don't have constitutional consequences. One central consequence that I think delegations have is that they impose an obligation of supervision. It's an obligation of supervision on the executive branch to exercise that kind of hierarchical supervision, but it's also an obligation of supervision that applies to Congress. Congress has to exercise that supervision. It has a constitutional obligation to do so, and it has a constitutional obligation to structure its delegations to enable that supervision. I don't think this supervision means simply hearings and investigations. I think it also means Congress responding to new problems and challenges by enacting legislation. I think it also means affirmative responsibilities on Congress that if it's going to delegate responsibilities to agencies, it should adequately fund them. Putting this somewhat differently, the recent constitutional showdowns over funding the government and Congress's inability to enact substantive legislation, I think, are not just signs of congressional dysfunction. I think these are instances of Congress failing to live up to its constitutional obligations. And I think that constitutional scholars have let Congress off too easily. They have focused on the constitutional structure and the difficulties that bicameralism and presentment impose on the enactment of legislation and in discussions of veto points to point out how this structure that we have for enacting legislation is not the structure we need today in the world, polarized world in which we live. That's in many ways all true. Nonetheless, it doesn't excuse Congress's failures. And having delegated broad power to the executive branch, Congress has a constitutional obligation to fund and adequately supervise and enact legislation to govern the delegations it has created. And that is what Congress is currently failing to do. Thank you.
So thanks to the Federalist Society for having me on this wonderful panel. I think it's extremely timely that this year's convention is focusing on the role of Congress. Because for many years, the Federalist Society has been talking about the judicial role, talking about the scope and the limits of executive power, but we only talk about Congress sort of in passing as an entity that's not living up to its constitutional powers. But Congress is, of course, really the foundation of the federal government. And so today I want to address the topic of adaptation and decline by focusing on what I call the collective Congress. So you may want to think about the collective Congress as sort of analogous to the unitary executive, right? The fact, you know, this is very familiar to us, that the fact of a single chief executive has important consequences for how executive power is exercised. Similarly, the structure of lawmaking requiring a collective Congress has important implications for the powers of Congress and the limits on Congress. And what I want to talk about a little bit today is how the modern administrative state has really unraveled this collective Congress, in part by giving individual lawmakers the ability to influence and to control aspects of administration. And this fragmentation, which is not just through delegation, but also occurs through polarization and other mechanisms, has really weakened Congress as an institution, and it provides at least some explanation for some of the current difficulties we see on the Hill. So let me first explain a little bit about what I mean when I talk about the collective Congress. So Article 1 of the Constitution vests all legislative power in a Congress of the United States, which shall consist of a Senate and House of Representatives. So fairly basic. You know, Congress is a multi-member body of representatives that comes together to enact laws. And I think we've lost a little bit of the importance of this fundamental idea, right? This is really the idea behind Republican government. We have representative government because it was designed to provide a solution for how a part of the society could come, parts of the society could come together to represent the whole. So in order to be legitimate, lawmaking has to occur through majorities or sometimes supermajorities of legislators. But it also means that individual lawmakers who represent only a part of this nation have no separate powers. They have only collective power. And in relation to this, the U.S. Constitution carefully separates out lawmaking from law execution. Lawmaking is given to the collective, it's given to the whole, whereas execution is given to a singular executive to oversee and to direct. And the separation, of course, exists throughout the text and structure of the Constitution. But specifically, it ensures that individual legislators who represent very particular constituencies have no role in execution, right? They cannot serve as executive officers. They cannot appoint executive officers. They cannot remove executive officers except through the constitutional processes of impeachment. And so the collective Congress provides another way of thinking about this line between executive power and legislative power. You know, Madison noted long ago that drawing this line was often extremely difficult in particular instances. Yet it seems to me that the blurring of these powers in the modern administrative state makes it all the more important to try to find different ways of thinking about this essential separation. And this is something that Justice Thomas wrote about in his separate opinion in the Amtrak case last term, in which he called for developing a more robust delegation doctrine. So it seems to me that a number of the problems we see result from the unraveling of the collective Congress and the ability of individual lawmakers to act on their own. And we see this most prominently with delegation and the administrative agencies. Delegation, as we know, gives agencies lots of discretion, and this has significantly expanded the power of the executive branch. But importantly, it also gives individual members of Congress a new source of power. Right? They can influence agencies. It helps them be solo practitioners, as Chris DeMuth said. And so this is, I think, often hidden from public view, how this works, but it's extremely pervasive. You know, just to give you one example, at a hearing this past summer on Dodd-Frank, Senator Franken said, He was making the point that the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau was responsive to Congress because he said, well, I've gone to the CFPB and, quote, I've gotten them to change their rules. So I go to them all the time and get changes. And, you know, I don't mean to pick on Senator Franken, but his quip reflects a reality that responsiveness to Congress by agencies is now often just responsiveness to single members. And so this fracturing of the collective Congress poses a number of problems. First, the Constitution doesn't give members any separate powers whatsoever. You know, historically, of course, members of Congress have tried to influence implementation of the laws, but delegation makes this problem much worse, precisely because agencies have a lot more discretion, so there's more for members to try to influence. So instead of making hard choices in statutes, members can go in kind of through the back door, and they can influence administrative decisions. And so part of what we see is that delegation erodes constitutional accountability in both of the political branches. It allows agencies functionally to make the law, and it allows congressmen functionally to administer the laws. And so through delegation, both of the branches make rules and interpret the rules, and this turns separation of powers on its head. Second, this individual action by members undermines Congress as an institution. We all know Congress holds the most significant powers in the government, and they could act, but they often have failed to in recent years. And I think this is in part because the energy and the interests of lawmakers are often directed elsewhere. They may focus on the success of their political parties, as Neil discussed, right? As I've said, they focus on administration. It's much easier to secure waivers or exemptions through agencies. Influencing administration is much easier than enacting laws. And so Congress, of course, has the lawmaking power, but the lawmaking power is often not what members are choosing to exercise. And as has already been mentioned too, this dynamic really has increased the power of the executive in relation to Congress. You know, the president and agencies are generally fairly happy to receive open-ended delegations. You know, this increases their authority, it gives them greater control over policymaking, and overlapping delegations in some areas really have encouraged unilateral presidential action. I mean, we've seen that with President Obama in a number of areas, particularly immigration. So delegation, as Neil also mentioned, you know, it fortifies the interests of the president with the executive branch, right? Like polarization, the president is bolstered by delegations. And at least since President Reagan, the White House has been centralizing administrative authority in the White House. And that centralization and control is far from complete. It could probably be better. But the point is that it tends to increase executive power. And so the delegations reinforce the ambitions of the president, but they uncouple the interests of members of Congress from Congress as an institution. But the collective Congress was really the mechanism for aligning the interests of a multi-member body, right? Why would individual congressmen pursue their ambitions to support Congress as an institution? Well, the answer to that is pretty straightforward in the Constitution itself. Members were given only a collective power. So to pursue their interests, they would have to enact laws. It would be difficult to do, but that was the only power they were given. But lawmaking is hard, as we all know, and there are all these collective action problems. So once now there are alternatives to lawmaking, you know, members will have other ways to look out for their interests. And the result has been that Congress as an institution has suffered. So here let me just close with something that Rousseau said in The Social Contract. He said, legislative power is the heart of the state. The executive power is the brain. A man may remain an imbecile and live, but once the heart has ceased its functions, the animal is dead. So it seems to me that the living Congress has to be a lawmaking Congress. Otherwise, it will simply continue its decline. Thank you.
I think I'll operate from here because I can see my notes better. Is it the mic's doing all right? Is this okay? All right. The living Congress, adaptation or decline. Let me start by asking, what is the standing of Congress? And one end today, and in the long run, the standing of Congress, a vague noun, but put it out there. And one answer to that is that in the job ratings, Congress is in the basement. I mean, 9%, 11%, it's down there. But that's not news, and especially low basement standing right now. But you go back 80 years, and generally speaking, people don't give good job ratings to Congress. I'm not even sure there's a downslope over the 80 years, although this is a low. People don't like the conflict, so they say they're not doing a good job. They don't like the output, so they put that. That's point one. I have two slides. Slide number one. There it is. Also, the American intelligentsia are not fans of Congress. You may have noticed that. Going all the way back, not back to Madison, but back to Woodrow Wilson in 1885, congressional government, not fans. There's a long history of hostile critiques by literati. You've seen these books in the drugstores. There are Congress on Trial, Fight Club Politics, A Broken Branch, Obstacle Course, all the way back throughout my lifetime. It's been decorated with book titles of this sort. Almost all of these, but not all, are hostile critiques of Congress by the intelligentsia. That's there. We know this. We live with it. We live with the basement ratings. We live with the non-fandom by the intelligentsia. Nothing new there. Slide number two. But the good news, or a piece of good news anyway, is that this also is a time series over several decades, scooping together the items that I and my research assistant could find. The basic institutional question, if you put it to the American public, of who should be making the policies, why the place of the Congress does really stand up. And there's a small family of questions here where it is put to the presidents of the Congress to be making the policies. And overwhelmingly, it's true in the 50s, it's true under Bush. This is an assortment here of conditions having to do with party and by whether the party control is divided or unified. It kind of makes for control over it all. So it's kind of, I kind of like this. It's good news that Congress standing is so high. You see it's up there at the bottom. 59%, 21%. I haven't seen a decently comparable question under Obama, but I've seen some that come close to being the name of the politicians or the parties in the question, which is not a great idea. But whatever evidence there is suggests that this time series is not being impaired by what's happened in the drift of history during the last decade. All right, I think it's very important that this standing of Congress stay where it apparently is. That is to say, very high. They should be making the policies, not the president. It's basic to the Constitution. Apparently, it's holding up. There's no downslope, and I think that's fine. I want to go on with and develop a line of thinking here, though, which addresses this question. What might be the threats be to the continuation of this standing? What might the threats be? And one could be, after all, imperious presidents who can impair the state of affairs and possibly, as a spin-off from that, impair the standing. I mean, presidents do have a tendency to be imperious. Obama's imperious. I mean, they just put a law in front of him. He's signing it, saying he can't close down Guantanamo. He's going to close it down anyway. That's imperiousness. He said he's going to close it down anyway. Does that, but I think that there's one line of thought about threats to the standing that I want to develop here, which is that. It's this, that in recent decades, going back, let's say, to the mid-80s, about a third of a century, something like that, both the Senate and the House have been moving away from majority rule, that is ruled by floor majorities. That is to say, controlled by floor majority, the median member of the 218 in the House, the 51 or 50 of the Senate. Moving away from that, yes, regardless of what party you're a member of, floor majority, so it's controlled by floor majority. Moving away from, in the Senate, in the case of the Senate, there is the well-known 60-vote pivot, the political scientists call it, which means you need to have 60 votes to do anything at all, not 51. That's familiar to everybody. There's also a thicket of complexity that's been thrown up in the Senate having to do with doing anything at all, partly courtesy of Harry Reid. In the House, there's the Hastert rule, which has come down. Now, the 60-vote pivot in the Senate, I'll call it that, that is the cloture, the quotes, there it is, the way it's operating. And the Hastert rule in the House, these are new kids on the block. The developments of the last 30 years or so, at least the Cartesian certitude of the 60-vote pivot is new. And the Hastert vote, the Hastert rule is new. The country went 200 years without a cloture pivot of this Cartesian certainty, or without a Hastert rule going into the mid-1980s. I mean, let me nail that down. In the case of the Senate, we may think that the filibuster has been there forever, and in some sense it has, but I'm talking about the certainty of it. And we do know that for long stretches of history, the civil rights bills were routinely filibustered successfully by the Senate in a circumstance of considerable intensity differential between the House and the Senate, between the North and the South, during those times. It was the intensity differential probably that allowed the filibuster to be so successfully exercised over a long period of time. But generally speaking, beyond that, until the 80s or so, policies are made by a majority rule in the Senate. If a majority really wanted it something, probably it could get it over a long period of time. It's hard to nail that down because most policies were made by big majorities anyway, but let me give you an instance. It's a counterfactual, but it's illuminating. And I remember this. Back in the early 1960s, when Kennedy was president, the Democrats were trying to enact Medicare. They finally enacted under Johnson a few years later, but under Kennedy, it was a big deal of an issue in 61 and 62. Many of you will remember, they put it up. The Democrats had about 48 votes in the Senate, but they didn't have 51. But everybody thought that if they had the 51, they could pass it. It really wasn't in question. That is, nobody thought they had to have 60 votes, or that it would have been 67 votes under the cloture rule of that time in order to enact the thing. That is, if they had the 51, they could do it. That was everybody's calculation, and I think it was a correct calculation, although it's a counterfactual. And you go through history and you find that. Many of the big tariff bills in history enacted by very, very narrow majorities. That's the Senate. In the House case, going back before the 80s or so, much more common was a kind of free-form coalition making, either in the Committee of the Whole or on the floor, the full floor, wherein people could combine as they wanted across party majorities or whatever to amend bills or to enact them. More free-form, more majoritarian and more free-form. In comes the Hastert rule, which says that in order for something to get to the floor, it needs to have the approval of the majority of the majority party. That's a new thing. It's a surprisingly development on the American scene. I don't know where it came from. It just kind of popped up in the 80s and the 90s, and now we live with it as we live the certitude of the cloture rule as it's used in the Senate, the 60 and so forth, the cloture. All right. Now, what I'm suggesting, this is entirely speculation, or mostly speculation, is that there may be costs to the coming into effect of these anti-majoritarian, in a sense. It's surprising to say that of the Hastert rule, but it is that, anti-majoritarian developments. One is that presidents have got more leeway probably to say, I'll do it myself. That is, if Congress is not acting because of occlusions in the House or in the Senate, there's more of a political opening for presidents to jump in and say, I'll do it myself. There's a possibility that this is being speculated about. It's just speculation, but it's plausible speculation that authority are drifting away somewhat, draining away some part as a consequence of these inclusions to the White House, to the agencies, and also to the courts. There's writing by Rick Hodson about this, for example. Another cost is that running the Senate or running the House is a very tough job. I mean, think of McConnell, or think of, actually, Bader gave up his job. It's very difficult to operate in the circumstance of the 60-vote pivot or the Hastert rule if you're trying to run the House and participate in running the country. It's also possible that we're in danger of getting an erosion of the legitimacy of Congress as a decision-making body as a consequence of these inclusions. I mean, Tea Party folks, for example, the section of the Republican Party, much of the Republican Party is quite unhappy with the way that bills are passed by the House and they go to the Senate and they disappear. It's like a river running into the Sahara. They get there and nothing happens. There's a quote in the Post this morning by Governor Nikki Haley of South Carolina. People are angry, she says. Why aren't there bills on the president's desk every day for him to veto? At least they could get that far. But take it from the other side, from the standpoint of the Democrats and the liberals, there's very little action on immigration policy. That is, the House will either keep, other Republicans will either keep immigration bills off the floor, or they will prevent, let's say, flexible coalition formation in a fashion that will allow the passage of bills over there. So as a result, on the immigration front, is it no one right now in the country is legitimizingly, put it that way, legitimizingly making national immigration policy. National immigration policy. Our result is that imperiousness by the presidency, and also pressure on the courts to make these decisions about immigration, or butt in and try to do something. Now, I think that for the public, probably votes up or down on things are an expectation, after all. Votes up or down, it's like football games. You have this side, you do, you have a result, Votes up or down. That's what legislatures are for, probably most voters will say, being aware of fun things of how their state legislatures and their city councils operate. So now I've started this talk with the, framed it as an exercise, an excursus on the standing of Congress. The standing of Congress with the public. Again, it's a vague noun. It means public, it means intelligentsia. And I do think it's very important to keep the standing of Congress up there where it still apparently is. It's in the face of difficult. Now I'm not saying that strict majority rule, that is to say you bring up something today and you pass it by one vote tomorrow, was the way any legislature should operate. That's simply not the case. Since you're always going to get collaboration and coalescing, you should get anyway, deliberation, the time span, messiness in the operation of a legislature. All those things will be true, and all those things we really want to have true if we think it through. However, the 60-vote pivot, the Hastert rule. I think that right now in the American checks and balances system, this was something like this was said yesterday morning on the panel by Akhil and by Amar and by Louis Fisher. Two things are operating pretty well. That is, generally speaking, the House, the Congress, the President, the courts are balancing each other. That's fine, as was designed. It's in order, as is my standing statistic. In addition, since 1980, that's about a third of a century, the party control of the national government has been divided over 75% of the time since 1980. That is to say, Democrats and Republicans have shared power. Only under 25% of the time has one party run everything formally, House, Senate, and presidency. That's also a check and a balance out there. It's a party check on it all. The position of the public seems to be that neither one of these parties can be trusted to run the government by itself for very long. So check it by midterm elections and by rotation and otherwise. That's also a check and a balance. I think with the basic operation of the system, how the Congress, the presidency, and the courts, and with the almost normal divided party control situation of things, it's not clear to me that we need additionally the occlusions of the Hastert rule in the House and the 60-vote pivot in the Senate. That's it.
So I'm going to ask the panelists to take an opportunity to add to their remarks or to respond to each other. But first, I'm going to pull a judge's trick because lawyers arguing cases hate hypotheticals, and I'm going to throw a hypothetical out that's purely theoretical because of the current state of the law. But I hope to use it as a springboard or a tool for examining what's really going on within Congress. I'm going to ask about term limits. Now, term limits, the Supreme Court has said, are not constitutional on the national scale. But there was a big push for term limits, as we all know, 10 years ago, 20 years ago. And the argument for term limits was, at least one of them was, that more senior members of Congress in both houses become a part of the problem, that they've essentially moved to Washington, that they care more about getting reelected than anything else, and that they don't invigorate the House or the Senate with with new, fresh ideas, and that it is, in some sense, anti-democratic. But there's a counter-argument to that, which is if there's a concern about too much delegation and entrenched power in independent agencies and executive departments, that you really want to have more senior members of Congress with more senior staff because they have the institutional memory and the power to counter, to some extent, the executive branch and the independent agencies. Take the Senate, for example. I mean, it would look very different, for example, if you had term limits. You would never have had a Strom Thurmond on one side or a Teddy Kennedy on the other, to take more extreme ideologies. But you also would never have had centrists such as Everett Dirksen, who was instrumental in finally seeing to it that the civil rights legislation of the 60s was enacted, or a centrist such as Lloyd Benson. So my question is this of the panelists. Speculate with me on whether it would make a difference if we had term limits in the House and the Senate in terms of the kind of issues that we've been talking about, whether it's a delegation or Congress getting its job done more effectively or more efficiently. Does anyone have any thoughts on that?
Let me take the bull by the horns here and say that I think that term limits is an example of, I adumbrated that reforms have to be consistent with the modern world. And I think of term limits as a form of romantic rebellion against the modern world. And I think that they would make our problems worse. An important part of the modern world is specialization. People don't like the fact that we have professional politicians, as opposed to Cincinnatus abandoning his wheel for a few years and coming to Washington. I think that would make things much worse. It would tend to move effective power more completely from the Congress to the executive agencies and to K Street, which is where you go most of the time after you have, quote, retired from Congress, or at least a congressional salary. It seems to me that that coming to grips with the political demands of the day suggests that we want more people to really devote their careers to Washington. And become true experts. I would like to see more people such as Paul Ryan, who have a tremendous mastery of particular areas of policy. I think we need much more of that in many more areas in the Congress. And we would be giving up the potential of building more human capital in the Congress if we simply said we want congressmen and senators to be the way they were in the good old days.
I largely agree, particularly with the idea that it's an attack on modernity and trying to go back to an earlier period. I just wanted to emphasize one other effect of it, which would be to the extent we're concerned about a lack of collectivity and an evisceration of sort of collective organisms. I think that in Congress, I think that such one of the effects of term limits would be a harm on party structures, and you'd have more likely individuals coming in with limited period and limited institutional commitment. And in addition, it doesn't seem like to me that that's necessary to get. If your concern is to have a check on a professional political class, if we simply created the means for more competitive elections, that might allow the better qualified to win without having such a destructive effect across the board.
Anyone else?
Yeah. I was going to largely say what Jillian had said, that I think the institutional interest of Congress, the ability for Congress to assert itself as an institution vis-a-vis the president, requires people who are committed not to a narrow policy agenda, but are committed to a broad range of issues, including the issue of congressional power. And term limits would shift focus to people of narrow policy interests away from potentially institutional broader interests.
Yeah, I wouldn't do it. I think the time for term limits was the early 90s, at a point where the Democrats have been running the House for 40 years. And it's not surprising that pressure built up and people said we should have term limits. But since then, party control has switched in the House 3 times and the Senate 5 times, which gives a kind of looseness, which wasn't there, and flexibility in the system going back, at least on the House side during those times. So the pressure has gone off. We don't hear an awful lot about term limits anymore, probably at least partly for that reason. I think as a more general point, it's that the risk with term limits by getting rid of experienced people, I know there's a trade-off. Experienced people, yes, there's a trade-off. You risk shunting off influence to bureaucrats and judges if you have short-termers and short-timers in the legislature.
Maybe I'll just play devil's advocate here. I'm not certain that I'm in favor of term limits necessarily, but it's not clear to me that the ineffectiveness of Congress is due to the lack of expertise, right? And so it may be that if there were term limits, it would attract a different kind of person to Washington to be in Congress, and those people would maybe more committed to Congress as an institution, knowing they're only going to be there for a short period of time. I think it's very hard to know because there's so many different things that would be affected by term limits.
So the comment was made on a panel yesterday that at first to me was counterintuitive, but maybe it makes sense, and that is, I mean, there's a complaint that that the congressional bureaucracy itself is too bloated, but the argument was made that actually congressional staffs are too small; they should be larger to develop internal expertise within the two houses of Congress to in some ways be able to question or at least counter the power of the agencies and the executive departments. So, any comment on that congressional staffing?
I think the emphasis in congressional reform has to be on questions of structure, hierarchy, prerogatives of the committees versus those of the party leadership. Let me say two things. I think that Newt Gingrich gets a little bit of a bum rap for having come in 1994 and eviscerating the staffs, abolishing the science office, cutting back on the government accountability office, cutting back on the congressional budget office and so forth, and limiting committee staffs. He was facing, people say, well, he was confused. He wanted to cut back on government, but he needed to build up Congress, not to cut back on government to Congress to do that well. But he was facing a situation where he regarded the large professional establishment in Congress as being part and parcel with the bad professional government downtown. He had a lot of things he wanted to do quickly. He wanted to centralize things dramatically in a party hierarchy, take power away from the committees, going beyond what Congress had done, what the Democrats had done in the early 1970s. But it was pretty effective. He accomplished a good deal of what he had set forth in the contract with America, which through regular process probably would not have been done. But I think that that approach has become obsolete today. And we need, for the long run, greater competition between the two branches, which requires greater capacity, which will involve more people in the Congress to accomplish. My favorite example, I hope nobody here is here from the Wall Street Journal editorial page, is the Congressional Budget Office, which has become really the most respected authoritative voice on budget issues, long-term budget problems. As OMB has become progressively more partisan, the CBO has been determinedly nonpartisan. It makes people of both parties furious all the time with the estimates that it makes. I think we need more truly disinterested analytical capability in the Congress.
And just to supplement that, limiting committee staff exacerbated polarization and partisanship in Congress and help shift power ultimately to the president. Reinvigorating committee staff might also reinvigorate working across party lines as staff and members develop expertise and have more robust authority and perhaps work better together as they once did.
Anything else? I'm wondering to what extent in the House of Representatives you think that congressional gerrymandering by state legislatures makes a difference one way or the other in terms of how that House ultimately functions.
The trouble with that argument is that the Senate is equally polarized and there's no gerrymandering in the Senate.
So essentially you would say it makes no difference to the
I could bristle with reforms to the districting process, but I think it's hard to argue that gerrymandering and things that have been done under the Voting Rights Act and so forth has been an important cause of polarization within the Congress, and the Senate is just such a powerful counterexample. So I would say if we turned districting over to Google and just said, make the most compact districts you can in every state. From the example of the Senate, I'd say I'm for that, but I don't think it would have too much effect on the polarization of our current politics.
Yeah, I think he's right about that.
Yeah, a lot of the polarization is a result of party primaries, and the party primaries is going to be the source, and that's what we see in the Senate.
All right, let me ask the panelists then to respond to anything that the others have said or add anything to what your opening remarks were, if any of you have any comment or disagreement on what the other members of the panel have said.
Judge, yeah. I'd like to make just a few. I'll try to be brief. I want to respond to an aside in Jillian's remarks. My argument about the causes of delegation are not that this is a rational response to the complexity of modern society. I'm not a Woodrow Wilson progressive. I acknowledge that there are elements of modern society that call for more administrative specialization than we have had in the past. In the United States, there is going to be government screening of new drugs for safety. That is going to happen. That is about a 95% approval rating, and it's very difficult to imagine committees of Congress deciding on whether one or another drug should be marketed. I'm not saying that there's nothing to the progressive argument, but my argument is that affluence and technology have changed the nature of politics. It has permitted an entrepreneurial style of politics on the for elected politicians and a profusion of very well-heeled, highly reticulated and effective interest groups on the demand side. That is not a matter of saying that good government has to contend with the complexity of modern society. There's nothing in the complexity of modern society that says that the Office of Civil Rights has to tell Yale University and Columbia and George Mason and William and Mary how to set up tribunals and what the standards of proof should be for he said, she said, sexual assault cases on those campuses. That is not a matter of complexity requiring Washington telling everybody in the country to march in lockstep. We have an enormous array of health, safety, environmental standards where you have to have the same energy efficiency standards for Maine and Texas that are enemies of complexity, that blot out desirable diversity. We have several agencies that set their own taxes. Now, the FCC has a $9 billion a year program. It adjusts the tax rate somewhere between 15 and 17% every quarter. That's not a matter of expertise. Congress is supposed to set tax rates, and there's no subtlety about the electromagnetic spectrum. The FCC simply decides how much money it wants to spend on a variety of programs for bill bringing internet to rural America and so forth, and sets the tax rate to raise the money. There's nothing about expertise in that. A very large number of what we see in programs in the administrative state are not the result of expertise required by the complexity of modern society. They are the advantages of specialization and the fact that Congress can respond to a profusion of demands only by setting up specialized programs for one after another program and leaving it to the executive branch. I agree, and I think that Professor Behu made a very important point. We have to beware when we're talking about congressional decline or failure of the fact that on paper, Congress has all the marbles. It's got all the powers. It can do anything. It can even fire judges. It can fire people in the executive branch. It's got standards for doing that, but it decides it itself. So it essentially controls everything, but it is beset by very deep collective action problems, which interfere with its ever being able to act tactically or to advance my political program or somebody else's political program. The decisions come out of it, it's kind of like a Ouija board. You don't really know where they come from. They often seem very arbitrary. It's very easy to criticize. So I think that modern discussions or discussions of congressional decline have to be aware of that. But I think that Congress's systematic sloughing off of traditional responsibilities that it was very, very jealous of in the lifetimes of some people in this room. I think that that is an empirically demonstrable development. I think we're in a different world. The executive unbound is a different world than we had in the 1950s. I do not think that public opinion polling of Congress versus the president, I don't think it tells us very much. The important thing, which really has changed, is that popular regard for government itself has declined precipitously over this long period. The executive, this is not good for the president. We might think it's good for the president. And again, you know, people attacked Thomas Jefferson, and we've had a lot of polarization in the past. But we've now had three successive presidents that have been subjected throughout their terms to highly, to concerted, well-financed efforts to undermine their personal integrity, to enact, to attack them personally. And the presidential campaigns are now a continuous business, attracts far more resources than congressional campaigns. This is all a reaction to the enormous centralization of power in the presidency. And so people of almost any persuasion and any causes that they care about, electing their guy or gal is the important thing. But it is not a good thing for society that we be so strongly polarized, and that the society be so politicized. I'm very much in favor of rolling back the Senate filibuster, and I would also say the Senate hold. Conservatives especially have a sort of romantic and untrue view of where the filibuster fits in history, and they see it as a good thing because it slows down legislation, and therefore they think the growth of government. That view is out of date. It is now the strongest policy we have on the Hill for empowering the solo practitioner. That is why the filibuster has such strength today, and it has become a vehicle for legislative passivity in the face of executive growth. And we're not going to, the Congress is not going to be able to counter executive lawmaking unless the Senate drops its House of Lords pretensions. And for routine legislation, I would actually retain the filibuster for life tenure judges, the inverse of what we're doing today. But for routine legislation and appropriations, we would still have a supermajority institution arising from bicameralism. But the Senate itself has to become a majority rule body.
Since I actually agree on the filibuster and the Hassert rule, I'm not going to speak so much to those, but I do want to respond on delegation. We obviously have a different view about the causes of delegation. I don't doubt that there is a fair bit of rent-seeking that underlies it as well. But I think it's always possible to identify something that agencies are doing that seems inane or excessive, and then attack the process of delegation. So if you just take the OCR issues recently about sexual harassment, there's nothing, what that is an implementation of constraints on discrimination in federal funds, and at the background delegation level, I don't think Congress has any ability to really police those the way an agency can. I think you do have to delegate that power to an agency. If you think an agency is exceeding the bounds of its delegation or is abusing its power, then the routine for that would be to either petition the agency, to try and bring political power in terms of investigation. You could always sue in court, but I think it's always a mistake to try and focus on particular inanities, and I can provide my own, of what agencies do in thinking about broader delegation. I do think that there are imperatives of the world that we live in that make delegation a necessity. I have more of a belief in expertise in government than Chris does. But whether it is politics or whether it is expertise or whether it comes from technology, I think it's a reality. I think it's a reality. This is the government that this country wants. It's a government that has delegated power and is able to address problems that people want addressed. And given that, I think that we need to, rather than try and fight delegation, we need to think more about the consequences of delegation and how to create a scheme once you have delegation that deals with potential abuses rather than trying to raise constitutional issues about it from the get-go.
We are going to have time for audience questions if anyone, well, we have the three microphones as with the previous session. Did anyone else have a follow-up on anything that we've?
That's okay, we can take questions.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm going to start with the back microphone because I think the gentleman there was there first. And
thank you very much, Judge. I just wanted to make sure you guys didn't filibuster anymore, so I stood up maybe in advance. But I'm Randy May, president of the Free State Foundation, and this question and comment is directed towards Professor Metzger on delegation. I just want to push back a little bit and then ask you about this. I think you said you don't believe that the courts are institutionally competent to police the non-delegation doctrine. And I think it's still good law, although I understand it's not invoked, and there have only been two cases holding delegations unconstitutional. But, you know, the Supreme Court said in the Hampton, J.W. Hampton case, that there must be an intelligible principle. It would look for an intelligible principle in order to uphold a delegation. I don't think the court has ever repudiated that J.W. Hampton holding, if I'm correct. So here's my question, and I understand the court has upheld, for example, the public interest doctrine against a delegation attack, but what is the intelligible principle to your mind when Congress delegates to the FCC, and of course so much of its activity is, you may know, takes place under the public interest delegation, what is that intelligible principle there? And maybe to supplement that,
have your question and we need to move on, so let's go ahead and
suppose Congress said to every agency, act in the public interest.
We have your question, thank you very much. Okay, anybody?
Sure. So, Randy, in terms of can I articulate what the intelligible principle is? as far as I understand the intelligible principle doctrine, it pretty much translates into whatever Congress says in the delegation. I think that the court has upheld such broad delegations that intelligible principle is simply a term it invokes that doesn't actually have meaningful bite. Where I think the courts do police delegation is in terms of how they read statutes, in terms of whether or not it's subconstitutional. It's in doctrines of statutory interpretation. It's in doctrines of administrative law. When they subject something to more searching review, when they require reasoned explanation, I think that's in part to make up for the lack, perhaps, in the congressional delegation. And that's where I think the courts should play a role, because that's where I think that they're the most effective.
Okay. Front row.
Professor Rao, I'm very sympathetic to your vision of the collective Congress as a matter of policy, but I heard you to be making not just a policy argument, but also an argument from constitutional structure. And I wonder, from that perspective, what do you make of the fact that the Constitution isn't more clear about this, and that it does speak about the Speaker of the House and the President of the Senate, and it does speak of officers of these houses, and gives them the power to make these rules that we're objecting to today.
Yeah, I think I think that the Constitution is pretty clear about this. I mean, they do mention that there will be certain leaders, right, of the houses, but I think it's pretty clear in that it gives Congress only really one power, right, except for a few exceptions. They have lawmaking power, and they can only exercise that together, right? And I think that excludes then lawmakers kind of acting on their own, especially to influence administration or the execution of the laws. So I think it's pretty clear. It's almost sort of the core of Article I. That's all they can do, and they have to do it together. So I think one of the real questions is, how do we incentivize Congress to exercise this lawmaking power? And I think that is a very difficult practical question, given where we are right now in modern government.
If I may add something to that, I agree completely that Congress's power is lawmaking. And indeed, when Congress launches investigations and go into court to enforce subpoenas, it's tied to its Article I lawmaking function. But that also cuts against, nothing that you said, Naomi, but cuts against the idea that Congress would go into court to help monitor the implementation of the law by defending federal statutes, and also cuts against the notion that Congress might be able to go into court, as it is in court today, to deal with the exercise of the appropriations power, that Congress must act bicamerally, not one house or the other, in the pursuit of legislative goals, with the exception of investigations which are left to either house under its own internal rules.
And I don't
I know, I wasn't suggesting you to disagree.
Yeah. At the very back microphone.
John Vorperian, government attorney from New York. Today's showcase panel, as well as yesterday, has prompted me to just wonder, and I ask for clarification. When Congress did operate under the seniority system, was there a greater impetus for those committee chair to challenge the executive branch? And I was just wondering what this panel would think of any reinstitution of that system to have greater addition of staff to a particular chair?
Well, Professor Mayhew's the one to answer this, but I'll just jump in. You can find lots of examples of, especially because most of the chairmen were Democrats, they especially enjoyed standing up to Democratic presidents. But I mean, that was really part of what they liked to do. The relevance of that is somewhat limited, because that was also a time when we had both conservative and liberal wings within both parties, which we do not have today. I would like to see a time when a committee chairman is attached to the institutional interests of the House or the Senate, even when the president is of his or her own party. I can point to it in the past, but the polarization and the emergence of the of a president that is a highly partisan, sort of an amalgamation of a bunch of partisan causes, is a new matter and makes things somewhat different. I do not think we'll get back. The seniority system was a system of tenure. You essentially had life tenure. I don't think we're ever going back to that. I think there will have to be an internal, it's going to be meritocratic to some degree, and we've been moving in that direction. The key is to give the chairman of a committee the ability to make decisions and essentially force people, at least of his own party, to go along with it. And that will be difficult. I thought you were going to ask about abuses, and if you go back to the old seniority system, you find an enormous amount of parochial, the use of the power of the committee chairman for parochial purposes, very much against the public interest. And I can only say that we could answer that today by publicity, which is much faster and more kind of relentless and pitiless than it ever was in the past.
It's very tough to answer. I really don't know. I would say maybe a little bit. I think of chairs back there with seniority who did challenge presidents, even in their own party, like Wilbur Mills challenging Johnson on tax policy or fiscal policy in 67, 68, or Fulbright going to the mat with Johnson. Right. However, in the 19th century, before they had a strong seniority system, the chairs were doing that sort of thing also, I mean, challenging presidents then. And right now, after all, the people who rise to the top of the committees have been there for a while. It's not as if they're freshmen. Like, take Carl Levin, who was there a long time in the Senate doing defense stuff. It's not all that different from the way things were 40 or 50 years ago. Maybe a little bit, but not much.
Okay, the middle mic.
If we can return to the limits of delegation, Professor Metzger, if Congress passed a law which just cut and pasted Article 1, Section 8 into a bill, and the president signed it, and it said, we will create a new super agency that shall exercise these powers on our behalf, is your position that there would be no judicially admissible way to declare that that exceeded the power of Congress to delegate its own power away?
Well, that's an interesting example, because you're making me think of an article by Eric Posner and Adrian Vermeule, where they argue basically all the delegation doctrine is that legislation has to be passed by Congress. So you may have actually come up with a hypothetical that implements their theory. I'm willing to go that far, but not too much in terms of the, you know, that's not the reality of today, right? Those aren't the problems we have today.
Thank you.
Nick Rosenkranz, Georgetown Law School. To what extent is congressional dysfunction actually driven by dubious statutory interpretation by the other branches? So to take a recent example, when the executive branch or the court tells us that exchange established by a state means actually exchange established by the federal government, does that make it more difficult then for Congress the next time to reach a compromise if they're afraid that the compromise they reach won't be enforced as written by the other branches?
I think it probably does. I mean, there's some dispute about whether Congress actually takes this into account, but I think it must make some difference. So when you have really open-ended delegations, oftentimes, and then you also have certain specific things in a statute, agencies will just go around the specifics by using their broad delegated power, right? There's some great examples with the CFPB and auto lenders, right? Specific exclusions for auto lenders, which the CFPB just gets around with some other broad authority it has somewhere in the statute. So even when Congress is trying to make deals, right? We may like deals, we may not, but that's just part of what they do. Even under broad delegations and under judicial deference, right? Those things are often just kind of interpreted away. So that's got to affect how they view what they're doing.
Just to chime in on that, though, I mean, I think it really is a question that does require empirical investigation, and the best examination of that are two articles written by Lisa Bressman and Abby Gluck. And I'm not sure that they come to a view akin to yours. And in fact, often Congress does have, you know, it understands that agencies will be acting against certain kinds of background approaches to how it's interpreting. And of course, your particular example, the evidence that came out in the Times right before the decision came down is that, in fact, the decision of the court was the thought that had dominated Congress. So that may not, the point being more broad, I can see, but that particular example I don't think shows it.
Yes, and one of the devices for controlling delegation is the oversight hearing. If you go back maybe 40 years, an oversight hearing would begin with the chairman asking some questions and then turning over the questioning to a counsel who really knew this stuff. Today you have each member gets 5 minutes, and the combination of the members themselves and the five-minute rule make effective questioning almost impossible. Do you think changing rules at that granular level might help in controlling delegation?
Anybody?
You know, I think a lot of the question is the attitude of Congress towards the administration. When John Dingell, for example, was chairing the Energy Committee, he was out to assert his prerogatives and couldn't care less who the president was a party of, which party the president was. It was motivated by a particular vision of where the government should be going on the issue. So I don't know if it's an issue of changing rules. It's an issue of changing attitudes and the recognition within Congress of the importance of the oversight function, the recognition within Congress, the importance of Congress having its own agenda and standing up for its own priorities. I don't think changing rules would matter much, you know, just based on past practice in Congress.
The middle, is that me?
Yeah.
Yeah. So quick question. So Professor Metzger talked about the courts shouldn't get involved in questions of delegation between the political branches. And I think a lot of us might be more comfortable with that if the court hadn't also said, oh, by the way, you can't, as an institution, keep control over what you're delegating to Congress, which is what it did in INS versus Chadha. And it's interesting that these three lines of cases, the non-delegation cases, the Chevron line of cases, and the legislative veto line of cases are all based on a premise of congressional supremacy that's been increasingly called into question on both left and right, at least if the law review articles are any indication. And so in a conference that's been dedicated to thinking about whether we should walk back Chevron, shouldn't we also be thinking as a next logical step about whether we should walk back INS versus Chadha?
If I can, I actually think that's a great point. I mean, there's a real conflict in the kind of analysis that takes such a formalist view in INS versus Chadha and then takes such a functionalist view when it comes to delegation. And if you see the current challenge as being too much power in the executive branch, then the question becomes, from a functionalist view, how do we reinstate systems of checks? Whether the legislative veto per se is the right one, but thinking more, making sure that the doctrines align at that level of institutional design so you don't create a gap, I think makes sense. And I've always thought that Justice White had a pretty powerful argument in dissent in INS versus Chadha.
Yeah, just to add to that a little bit, Chadha has accomplished far less than one might suppose just looking at the case itself and what Justice White predicted in his dissent. Congress has enacted hundreds and hundreds of legislative vetoes since Chadha, many more since Chadha than in the era before Chadha, and presidents routinely complain about this but nonetheless adhere to it because they want, if you will, the delegation that Congress is willing to give them with the string of some type of committee or House veto.
But excuse me, so that's an important point that goes to Naomi Rao's, which I hope she addresses, because it's a very different thing for a committee to exercise informally or formally some legislative veto than for Congress to do it collectively.
Yeah, I mean, you know, they continue to enact them, but they haven't exercised any legislative vetoes either, right? It's all informal. And so I think, you know, I think one of the interesting things is because we've kind of given up on all the first best solutions, right, having a real non-delegation doctrine or having robust judicial review of what agencies are doing, then we're in this realm of all, I think Jillian called it the sub-constitutional, right, you know, trying to figure out what kinds of checks we can put on things because we've given up on the original checks and balances. And I think that is a very hard thing to figure out because the original checks and balances were very carefully designed, and then now there's a sense in which we're just making it up, so.
Question.
Th-
Thank you so much for sharing your insights with us today. My question is related to the power of the purse, and I'm wondering how many of the problems that you talked about today, so the power that inheres in administrative agencies, and also the power of individual Congress members as opposed to Congress acting as a whole, is related to the way that our budgeting process happens today. So I'm wondering, first of all, in an era where we have rule by continuing resolution, and also where a significant portion of the budget goes directly to federal agencies without any consideration, how much do you think that influences or has caused the problems that we have today? And what would happen if we returned to something like zero-based budgeting?
That's a good point. It probably would affect things, yeah. I mean, there's a sense in which, and I think, you know, Chris DeMuth mentioned this, you know, Congress has given up not just delegations of lawmaking authority, but all sorts of other powers, right? You know, they're not exercising a robust power of the purse. They give over powers of taxation, and that all affects this dynamic.
Also, though, to jump in on appropriations, I mean, I think you can also make an argument that Congress has been irresponsible in terms of enjoying the politics and the rhetoric of not funding, while at the same time, you know, delegating responsibilities and creating statutory laws that require enforcement. I think that if you want to be thoroughgoing about exercising control, simply doing it through appropriations while getting the political cover of the delegation strikes me as not living up to your constitutional obligations either.
Okay, one last quick question.
Thank you. I'd like to ask, continuing on the theme of oversight, how that would look, basically some flesh on it, how it would look, particularly with respect to an agency like the CFPB, which seems to be both walled off from the executive and the legislature because it, from what I understand, is not controlled by appropriations and is also not like a multi-member commission like some other agencies from the New Deal. So what, I guess, would oversight look like in those agencies, in like a modern one like the CFPB versus an old one? How might that be different?
Well, just to jump in, I mean, the CFPB has a fascinating structure. But in addition, you know, the CFPB was created at the same time you had FSOC created, the Financial Stability Oversight Council, which has the power by a two-thirds vote to overturn the CFPB's rules, the requirements of consultation with other agencies. So it's less of a direct hierarchical ability to overturn, but there are some interesting institutional design checks that are there. There's also the way in which some of the rules could be enforced by the states, which was something else that I mentioned. So you have more of a horizontal system built into the institutional design that exercises a variety of constraints on the agency, despite not having the funding constraint and having the single person structure at the top. Right now, agencies, I mean, that have the bipartisan collective structure at the top, because of polarization, are becoming increasingly unable to function. At the point at which the FEC chair petitions her own agency to adopt a rule, we might want to call into question, at least when it's an even numbered division at the top, right?
Oversight is a powerful tool in the hands of a powerful Congress. In the hands of a weak and flaccid Congress, it's like a think academic seminar or an excuse for simply evasion and getting through the hour.
I think for the CFPB, the answer in some ways is pretty straightforward. It's an executive branch agency, and it should answer to the president, right? Removal restrictions or whatever notwithstanding. And so the oversight should be from the White House because it's part of the executive branch. And so it's an executive agency and not independent in any constitutional way. So,
all right, it's lunchtime. Let's thank our panel for a great job.